Okay, here we go. Stand by. 3, 2, 1, action.
Assume nothing.
Brash, bald-faced blasphemy.
Question everything.
I find it extremely hard to imagine.
Open your eyes.
It is quite all right to be an atheist.
The fastest growing group of people in the country has been measured as being those who have no belief or who are atheists.
You don't have to be apologetic or quiet about it.
Challenge the opposition.
You see religion on 100 fronts losing the argument.
And start thinking. This is The Thinking Atheist Worldwide.
Snack smarter in the new year with our show sponsor. It is Nature Box, giving you 50% off your first box right now if you log on to naturebox.com/thinkingatheist. That's naturebox.com/thinkingatheist. Starting next Tuesday, I'm going to be doing a two-part series of shows titled Medical Neglect in the Name of God. What brought it to my mind was, among other things, I've been following the story of this guy who's Jesus this and Jesus that and praise Jesus, whatnot, was given a cancer diagnosis. And he is putting his faith in Jesus while at the same time he's rejecting the science-based solutions that were given to him by his physician here in the United States. And he's carted himself over to Tijuana for coffee enemas and detox foot baths, thinking that those were going to cure his cancer. You know, and his body's just disintegrating. He's posting his story very publicly online, and I'm just fascinated by it because he's not a stupid man, right? He's not an unintelligent guy. I mean, you listen to him speak, you think this is a guy who he's probably not reckless in most of the other areas of his life, but he has sort of created an exception here, and it just may kill him. And I guess that in some way ties into the broadcast tonight, right? Why smart people believe stupid things. But the whole healthcare thing had kind of been on my mind. Well, then I had been introduced to a new book by a doctor, a physician in Pennsylvania named Paul Offit. He'd written a book in 2015 called Bad Faith, When Religious Belief Undermines Modern Medicine. And I picked up the book and I thought it had merit. He's going to join me on the 2nd of February on the broadcast. And in the first chapter of his book, he highlights the story of Rita Swan. Now, Rita Swan was a devout Christian Scientist back in the 1970s, and her child became critically ill. And the church was seeing all the pain and suffering of this young child and said, oh, this is God merely working in the child. You know, praise Jesus, it's a miracle kind of thing. The child did finally, ultimately end up in a hospital. He ended up in intensive care and was dead at the age of 16 months. 16 months, because his parents were instructed by their church that it was a sin to take their son to the hospital. And Rita, since, dedicated her life, decades of her life, to exposing this kind of destructive teaching and to be an advocate for children in faith-based environments all around the world. In fact, she's the director of an organization called Child Incorporated. Child stands for Children's Healthcare is a Legal Duty. And she's going to join me next Tuesday. And that's going to be a series of just very compelling shows. I'm interested to hear what both of these people have to say, what their experiences have been, and what we can do to be an advocate for these poor kids who are at the mercy of their brainwashed parents, you know. And again, this ties into what we're talking about tonight to a degree. I would wager that many of the people who come out of the Christian Science Church and other types of environments who make these destructive decisions in regard to their own health and the health of their children, they're probably intelligent and make intelligent decisions in many of the other aspects of their lives. How do otherwise reasonable people do and believe such unreasonable things? And why is so often the cause for this unreason, religion? Here's an example, just an odd, bizarre belief that was taken seriously because of a religious faith, okay? My grandmother passed away when she was 90. She was a beautiful woman, just a tremendously sweet, wonderful woman. and I have only fond memories of my grandmother growing up. She had a rich, full, long, wonderful life, just filled with love and lots of laughter. Just a terrific woman. Died at the age of 90, okay? And I don't remember a lot about the funeral, except that it happened in two parts. They had the inside church service portion of the funeral, and then we had the gravesite funeral. And I mostly remember the gravesite funeral, where they gave a short eulogy, and they had her casket on a platform. They had this seated area, kind of a tented area with seats and the sort of the green faux carpeted grassy thing that they had put out. And then there was a big hole that had been dug, the grave. And then her casket was on this platform, and she was lying there with the casket open so she could be viewed. And she looked, if you'll pardon the cliche, like she was sleeping. She just looked peaceful. And it was a somber occasion, but also, you know, kind of a beautiful occasion as we remembered the life of this woman. And yet some members of my family, before the service had started there at the gravesite, were distressed. I mean, genuinely distressed, because my grandmother's casket, which was sitting there on the platform, was facing west. When I heard somebody mention this, I had no idea what they were talking about. She happens to be facing west. Yeah, what's the problem? No. She needs to be facing east. And it was then that I learned that in Christian tradition, as Christians believe that Jesus will return, he'll appear in the east when the second coming happens, when you are buried, you are to be buried facing the east so that you might see Jesus upon his return. And there was whispering, hey, make sure before they lower her into the ground that they spin the casket 180 degrees so she's facing east. Very important. Very important. Now, these are intelligent people. I kid you not. Very intelligent people. Professional people, people who deal in rational ways with the real world all the time. But in this particular instance, in regard to their faith, they were convinced, I guess, that upon the second coming of their Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, if Grandma was facing the wrong direction, Jesus was going to forget about her. And you could have probably heard the sigh of relief when the funeral home employees took the casket and turned it and spun it 180 degrees so that Grandma was facing east so she could see Jesus. And the service was finished and she was lowered into the ground. Reasonable people, intelligent people, hung up on this one, let's face it, really stupid detail. I mean, let's just think about it in practical terms. Jesus comes back, right? The second coming, the rapture happens. And the sky parts and the trumpet blows, and Jesus descends with the angels, and he's levitating there in the air to bring his people home, his people who are buried facing east. Wait a minute. On what part of planet Earth has Jesus descended? Because if he descends in, say, California, most of the rest of the United States is pretty much screwed. What if Jesus descends over another part of the globe? There are Christians all over the planet, so it doesn't have to be the United States. What happens if it's on the opposite side of the planet? Then what direction do we face? If it's completely, perfectly equidistant to where I happen to be standing here in the United States, couldn't I look either direction to see him? And actually, without a flat Earth, would God be bending the laws of physics and dramatically improving my eyesight so I could somehow see him standing in Russia or Pakistan, or, you know, just to make a point? Jesus came back. He came back over Pakistan. I mean, how does this work? It makes no sense. What about the people who aren't facing east? I just picture Jesus walking through a cemetery. No, he's picking like you would pick somebody to be on your team in elementary gym class. You. Oh, shit, Grandma's facing the wrong direction. She totally got missed. And Jesus is gone. He left. I mean, an omniscient Jesus would pretty much know exactly who she was, where she lived, when she died, where she was buried, and in what direction she was facing. It makes no sense. if your soul goes to heaven when you die, and people have been dying, Christians have been dying over the past over two millennia, and their souls go straight to heaven, what exactly is resurrected from the cemeteries when Jesus returns again? Do the decomposed bodies recompose and become fully whole, and then they go up? And then what about the souls? The souls that have been residing in heaven, hanging out with Jesus already for hundreds, perhaps thousands of years. Does God take the souls, put them back into the bodies, into the ground, so that they can then be resurrected? How does that work? And does he ignore those who were not facing east? This is an example of smart people believing really stupid stuff. And that is what our show is about tonight. We will have examples sent in by our listeners, and we'll cap the show with about a 35-minute conversation with Dr. Michael Shermer, the founder of Skeptic Magazine and the author of the book, Why People Believe Weird Things. Why do smart people, people otherwise reasonable and rational, in the rest of their lives, why do they cordon off this one little section, or maybe multiple sections of their lives, where they embrace and cultivate and protect and extol what you and I would call batshittery? That's the topic of the broadcast tonight. Of course, you'll see a pattern. You know, much of it revolves around religious belief. Not all of it, certainly. Not all of it, but much of it revolves around religious belief and even mainstream, in fact, especially mainstream religious beliefs, which seen in a more objective light don't really seem all that reasonable when you think about them. Valerie Tirico is a psychologist based in Seattle and an author. She's been on the radio a few times. She did an article for Alternet a few years ago called The 20 Weirdest Religious Beliefs. And she says in the article, how many of these weird religious beliefs can you match up with its familiar religious tradition? In other words, which religion does this belong to? And just a few of them in her list of strange beliefs. The foreskin of a holy one may lie safeguarded in reliquaries made of gold and crystal and inlaid with gems, or it may have ascended into the heavens all by itself. Of course, this relates to ancient Christianity and Catholicism. The holy foreskin is apparently a thing. Throughout history, several churches throughout Europe have claimed that they possessed Jesus' foreskin, and it has miraculous powers. A race of giants once roamed the earth, the result of women and demigods interbreeding. They lived at the same time as fire-breathing dragons. That is straight out of the Bible. As well as evil spirits who take control of pigs, a talking donkey scolding a prophet. Here's one out of Islam. A prophet once traveled between two cities on a miniature flying horse with the face of a woman and the tail of a peacock. Of course, that's referencing the al-Barak, the steed, in Islamic mythology, a creature from the heavens that transported the prophets. Sacred underwear protects believers from spiritual contamination and, according to some adherents, from fire and speeding bullets. That's an easy one. Of course, we're talking about the Mormons. And just in case you think that no one who is intelligent can adhere to Mormon teaching, Stephanie Meyer, the author of the Twilight series, a Mormon, former Senate Majority Leader Harry Reid, said he adhered to Mormon values. Bill Marriott, CEO of Marriott Hotels, not a stupid man, believes in Mormon doctrine. He believes the Joseph Smith story and the golden plates written in Reformed Egyptian and the angels Mormon and Moroni and the tradition of wearing temple garments. In fact, he told Mike Wallace back in the mid-90s during a 60 Minutes interview that he personally believed that his Mormon magic underwear, his temple garments, actually kept his skin from burning when he was in a boat fire. He actually believed this, and he's not an idiot, but he believes something that's really, really stupid. If the only protection you have during a boat fire is unbleached cotton, well, you're screwed. But if it's blessed and has the sacred Mormon symbols on them, now you got some real protection. But getting back to Valerie Tirico's list of examples here, When certain rites are performed beforehand, bread turns into human flesh after it is swallowed. Communion. Sprinkling water on a newborn, if done correctly, can keep the baby from eons of suffering should he or she die prematurely. Now we're talking about Catholicism. These are mainstream faiths. Putting a dirty milk glass and a plate from a roast beef sandwich in the same dishwasher can contaminate your soul. This is a problem if you are an Orthodox Jew. What kind of weird stuff do our listeners have to bring to the table? Let's find out. Area code 614, you're on the Thinking Atheist radio podcast. Who's this?
Hey, Seth, this is Kyle.
Kyle, we're talking about weird beliefs. Have you had, or do you have, a weird belief for the broadcast tonight?
I do, yeah. So, you know, I was raised in an extremely fundamentalist Pentecostal background. I was pretty much indoctrinated from birth into the church that I grew up in. And as you probably would suspect, a church like that comes with a lot of woo baggage. I think the church that we went to had routinely propagated this idea that if you went to the movies or if you had cable or a TV in your house, that you would most likely miss the rapture, second coming of Christ. You have to face the tribulation.
Wait, hang on, Kyle. Hang on.
Yeah.
All right. If you have a television in your house, you will be skipped when Jesus comes back?
Yeah. Yes, that was a part of the woo.
Sorry to interrupt you there. I was making sure I heard this correctly, because that's pretty extreme. Do you know how they got there? Was it that the television is some kind of a channel of evil influence into your home? Or is it like having the, you know, is it like having the mark on the door? I mean, what was the story?
I mean, you pretty much nailed it. You hit the nail on the head. I mean, if you were watching things that you weren't supposed to or was considered bad or evil, that would be a channel for spirits to basically come into your home and get off onto you, that type of thing. So
it's a literal channel. It's a television channel for evil.
Yes.
So did this freak you out when you were growing up?
Well, no. You know, I mean, I lived in this echo chamber of just church and my family, and I never really sat down to think it through. So, well, the funny thing is when we, you know, our family didn't have a TV because of this. In fact, most of the people in the church, at least at one time, didn't. But we did have a computer monitor. So the way we kind of circumvented this is we have a computer monitor, and then we just hook up a VCR, and we'd go to Blockbuster or the library and get a movie, and we'd watch it. Well, the woo gets a little bit crazier, because what I noticed is that every time we got done watching a movie, my mother would always put the movie out into the garage. I mean, it didn't matter what we were watching. It could have been Bambi, it went in the garage. It could have been The Fugitive, it went in the garage. So I remember, now I'm only 8 or 9 years old, but I remember asking, you know, at the time, why are you putting these movies in the garage? And she tells me, because we don't want the spirits to get off onto us. And I'm thinking, okay, I don't really question it. So I go on doing this for years, putting the movies in the garage when I'm done watching them. Well, now 25 years later, when I have a little bit of logic under my belt and critical thinking, I got to sit here and wonder, what the hell was I thinking? I mean, first of all, what, is the garage going to have some sort of magical protection that keeps the spirits from coming into the house? And I mean, not to mention that we had just spent the past 2 hours watching the movie inside the house. So by our own theory, we should be covered with spirits anyway.
It sort of betrays ridiculous. The desire to connect with that kind of material anyway. Your folks wouldn't have allowed the videotape to be in the living room if maybe on some level they didn't lament the fact that it was forbidden. You know, oh, let's do it, but we'll create a scenario where we then protect ourselves afterwards. It's like they really betrayed what they wanted to do while they were worried about what they should do.
Exactly, yes.
Did you have a moment of epiphany where you thought, oh my God, what was I thinking? Or was it more gradual than that?
It was gradual. I went through a deconversion process several years ago. And through this process, I'm kind of starting to recall all these things in my childhood, because I stopped going to that particular church in my early 20s, and then went on to go to some other churches. But I started remembering all these things and thinking through them and thinking, wow, I really used to do that. I really used to subscribe to these theories.
Well, thanks for sharing your story on the broadcast tonight. I'll go check through all my boxes of VHS tapes from, you know, the 90s. And we'll have a priest come by and do whatever incantation is required to make sure that we're protected in this house, Kyle.
Yeah, and
thanks for sharing and Happy New Year, and appreciate you being a part of the broadcast, my friend.
Thanks, Seth. Thanks for all you do. Thanks.
Now, while we're talking about examples of stupid stuff that's believed by otherwise smart people, it's just popped into my mind. I had this friend in broadcasting back in the 90s, hugely intelligent and talented person. She was a popular morning show host here in town. And, you know, we sort of crossed paths quite a bit and became friends. And I don't know how this came up in conversation. We were just swapping stories. And she told me that her mother had told her, and she believed into adulthood for a period of years, that if a girl ever wore a boy's jeans, she could get pregnant. I'm not exactly sure the context of swapping the jeans. I'm not sure how you're wearing the boy's jeans. But if for any reason you wear the boy's jeans, beware, because you could end up pregnant. And she, as an adult, as a young adult, believed this. Bill sent a message on Facebook, and he said he used to believe, seriously believe, that if your favorite sports team was in the playoffs, didn't specify a sport, I'm guessing any sport, and if you'd put a hat with their logo on the bed, that team is destined to lose in the playoffs. Bill says he doesn't buy it anymore, but, quote, I still won't tempt fate. Stacy said she used to believe in crystal healing. On the bright side, she says, she now has lots and lots of pretty rocks. Barry said he used to believe males had one less rib than females. Because, you know, in the book of Genesis, God took Adam's rib. The science doesn't even make sense. God took Adam's rib and he made Eve with it. And ever since, men have had one less rib than females. And I've actually heard people in mainstream Christian culture who actually believe this. It's an easily solved question, is it not? It's easy to check this stuff. But no, believing that Adam has one less rib, well, that validates the book of Genesis. Therefore, it must be true. Kim said, I used to be afraid of microwaving my food for fear of making my food radioactive. I heard this one, too. I've heard this one. Don't microwave your food. All that radiation can't be good for you. Terrible. Heather sent this on Facebook. She said, I still have a hard time if talk about tragic accidents comes up before I go on any trip, by air or car. I keep thinking if you talk about it, it'll happen, even though I know it's utter nonsense, kind of like, hey, don't jinx it. Heather, the one we heard was the best time to get on an airplane is right after a plane crash. That's the one we used to hear. You know, once there's a crash, then you know it's going to be safe for a while because we've had our crash for this season or this year or whatever, right? Like the universe was saving up and building pressure and building pressure, and all of a sudden tragedy happened. Then it resets to zero, then it's safe or safer to get on an airplane. That's the one we used to hear. Chris said, before becoming an atheist, I believed that the reason haunted houses were always older houses was because the lead paint kept spirit energy trapped inside. Something about the texture of lead paint just absorbed spirits and spirit energy, I guess. Back to the switchboard. Area code 207, you are on the Thinking Atheist Radio podcast. Who is this?
This is Chris.
Chris, thanks for calling the show. We're talking about why smart people believe stupid stuff, and I guess we're all guilty of that. Do you have a story for us?
I sure do. Back in the 80s, I grew up in the midst of the Satanic Panic, which you are familiar with and most of the listeners are.
Oh, yeah.
I was a gamer. I still am. I love playing games, board games, video games. But my father, who was a really devout Christian, would not let me play role-playing games because he believed that not only were the books that were used, the player's manuals, the dungeon master guide, stuff that, not only were those demonic, the dice themselves were demonic, which was really weird. Basically, you've got your platonic solids, you got your 4-sided, 6, 8, 10, 12, and 20-sided dice, and he said those, each one had a little demon in them.
No, so, you know, I've heard much of the same stuff. Don't touch.
Yeah.
Don't get near them. You might become infected in some way with evil.
Yeah, it's crazy. So here I am as an 11-year-old with a very active imagination. I loved reading Tolkien. I liked reading Piers Anthony, Isaac Asimov, any type of science fiction fantasy I could get my hands on and read, I would read. And then D&D come along, I'm like, oh, you can be like a wizard and cast spells and stuff like that. But no way would my dad let me play D&D. In fact, I had snuck a D&D book into the house and he found it and he flipped out on me.
Well, I was going to say, most of the people that I knew, even in private Christian school, who were warned about D&D, found a way to play anyway. So you were you did it anyway?
Yeah, actually, I did it in a way that, for some reason, it was okay. There was a D&D-like game back in the 80s called Star Frontiers, and it was basically D&D in space without the magic. You had lasers, and you could pilot starships and everything, so there was no magic and no deity overhanging everything, so it was a very science-ish based role-playing game. And he was fine with me playing that, because it had nothing to do with...
Sure. The devil and hell and demons
and
all that.
The devil and hell and casting spells and using gestures. Because I think what happened was that when the original D&D books came out, you would open them up and they would show you the patterns that the wizards would use to cast spells. And you would see pentagrams with circles around them and other things. And the religious people back then saw that and flipped out. It was crazy, you know? So that taken into account, you know, I can understand why my dad didn't like that, but as a kid who wanted something to do with geeky friends, I wasn't into sports. I wasn't into much of anything except for like playing chess and typical nerd stuff, you know, from the 80s. So it was really interesting to, as I grow up, you know, be able to say, you know what, I'm in charge of my own life now. You know, I mean, I'm teaching my girlfriend's son how to play Dungeons and Dragons, you know, and he's 11. He's at the age that I was when I was a kid.
That's terrific. You know, you get a chance to encourage imagination and creative thinking and friendly competition and all that.
Yeah, it's a lot of fun, you know, and it's funny. I actually collect dice now, you know, so those demonic dice that I had that my dad would not let me have growing up, I've purchased hundreds of dice. So, like, I will buy a game if it has funky dice with different stuff on it, like letters or just different number patterns or symbols or something. I say, oh, that's a really cool looking dice. And I buy it and I put it in my collection and I just, you know, have a bunch of weird dice.
I'm glad it sort of translated into a hobby that you enjoy. And thanks for sharing your weird belief on the radio.
Hey, not a problem, Seth. You have a great day.
Area code 540, you're on the Thinking Atheist Radio podcast. Who's this?
This is Kayla.
Kayla, we're talking about strange or stupid beliefs. What do you have for the broadcast?
I have one that I don't usually share now that I'm more skeptical. But I was raised in a church that believed in the idea of that demons were very real, that they existed in literal physical supernatural form all around us, and they believed that there were two ways that demons could bother people. They could possess you or they could oppress you. If you weren't saved, you could be possessed, which is, you know, demon takes over and climbs in the driver's seat and uses you for whatever they want. If you were a Christian, though, because you had Jesus in your heart, he would fight off the demons and they could only oppress you from the outside. And the way that they would do that is you would have to kind of leave a door open in your life somewhere where they could get in and start to really bother you. So basically, the more godly you were and the less you had worldly influences around you, the less chance there was that the demons would get in. And one of the most common examples that our pastors would give was playing with a Ouija board as a way of letting demons in, because you would commune with the spirits and you were inviting them to talk to you. And that would invite them to latch onto you.
It's like the Dungeons and Dragons dice in the previous call. These aren't just innocuous objects. These are doorways to another, possibly sinister realm.
Exactly, exactly. And I really wish, it would be bad enough, I believe, that, you know, I was raised in church as a kid and a teenager and stuff, but it followed me even well out of my parents' house. I can remember I was managing a toy store in my early 20s, and when one would fall off the shelf, wrapped in a box, I would ask one of my staff to pick it up because I would not touch it.
How'd you finally shake all this?
I have no idea. It was a long, slow process, but part of it was, I think my spouse went to Afghanistan, and I'd already been questioning for years, and he came back, and he was more of a cultural Christian starting out anyway, but he came back with no room for religion in his life anywhere. He had seen it up close and personal in some very fundamental ways, and he doesn't draw much of a line between fundamental religious people of one faith or another. He thinks they're pretty much all the same. So he would kind of challenge me on beliefs that I held, and the Ouija board one was way too much for him. He was like, wait, what? You believe what? And just kind of led me into reading on it a little bit. And when I kind of found out the history of it, I was like, wait a second, why exactly am I afraid of this again? Especially when you consider the fact that, like, Parker's Brothers owns it now.
Oh, yeah, the board game company, yeah. You know, yeah. You've got me interested, though. I'd like to look up the history of the Ouija board. How did this game or process or phenomenon get started? Now I'm all curious. I'm going to have to go and do some homework on it. So
it's pretty interesting.
Well, I'm glad you escaped. You doing okay these days?
I am. Thank you, Seth.
Wonderful. Well, thanks for sharing your story on the radio. Happy New Year, and take care of yourself, okay?
Thank you. You too.
Area code 506, you're on the Thinking Atheist Radio podcast. Who is this?
Steve calling.
Steve, we're talking about strange beliefs that we used to hold, or perhaps continue to hold. Do you have something for the show?
I was born and raised a Catholic, and when I was young, I can remember that we always used to go out around Easter. My mother always believed that God blessed all the waters on the earth at Easter time. And I can't remember if it was Good Friday or the Saturday or Easter Sunday. But I remember we had to go out at midnight on that particular day. And we had to go to a brook and fill up some bottles of this blessed water, if you will. And we always brought some of it home, and there were always bottles of this holy water or blessed water around the house. And Mom would give it to us if we were sick or, you know, anything like that. So, yeah, that was one of the really weird things that I can remember growing up.
So God blessed every drop of water on planet Earth on Easter?
Apparently so.
Kind of a bad day for vampires then, right? I mean,
absolutely, yeah.
Shit, what are we going to do for 24 hours? All the water on planet Earth is completely blessed. Now, I don't see this as mainstream Catholicism. Like, I've never heard this before. Is this just something your mom drummed up?
You know, I couldn't tell you. I can remember doing this up until I was about, you know, 13 or 14 years old. And after that, I sort of became a disbeliever, and I didn't go to church very much after that. And I don't recall if they still went and did that, but I would bet you $10 that if I went to their house now, that there's still bottles of holy water around. No idea how old they are, but
you'd be in bed at midnight. They'd come knock on the door. Hey, it's time to go round up the agua, my friend.
So. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. And I live in, you know, in New Brunswick, Canada, and our winter around Easter, there's, you know, easily 4 or 5 feet of snow on the ground. So we had to do some trudging to get to a brook.
I figured you for Canada with the about. Yeah. I figured you for up north somewhere. Steve, thanks for sharing your strange belief. And this coming Easter, you know, if I think of it, we'll go out and grab some canisters, you know.
Sounds great.
All right, man. Have a great one.
Take care.
It's always interesting to look at the strange superstitions that many adults hold for all of their lives in many cases. Bizarre and unreasonable beliefs. What's that about? Did you know that in Russia, If you buy flowers to thank someone, don't give them yellow flowers. Yellow flowers represent infidelity. Something about yellow flowers makes them crazy. And don't give a dozen because somehow they've linked a dozen flowers to the dead. You've heard of Shakespeare's Romeo and Juliet. Well, there's apparently a statue of Juliet in Italy that's become a shrine to true love. And people will travel to this place, to the statue of Juliet, and they will grab her right breast to give them good luck in their own relationships. And no, I'm not making this up. By the way, there's a similar ritual in Paris. Victor Noir's tomb, the late French journalist, there's a bronze statue of the guy, and he's lying down. And it said that if you rub the groin area of his statue, that brings you good luck in love and fertility. And so many people have rubbed the crotch on the statue that it's actually discolored it. It's bizarre to look at. They had to build a fence around it years ago, but it still doesn't keep people from climbing over and getting in. In Tokyo, there's a tradition that blesses young children, and it involves sumo wrestlers. And this is promoted by a great many otherwise reasonable adults. Two opposing sumo wrestlers in a ring will hold babies that were born in the prior year, and they will try to make the baby of the other sumo wrestler, the one that's on the other side of the ring, they'll try to make the opposite baby cry. This is a contest called Naki Sumo, and it serves as a prayer to ensure the baby's health. In India, they won't cut your hair on a Tuesday. Because for some reason, cutting your hair on a Tuesday is considered bad luck. They just close the barbershops. Don't even open them. And don't cut your nails after dark. Before the sun goes down is fine. After that, you've jinxed yourself somehow. Apparently, people in China and Japan are weird about the number 4. They avoid the number in buildings. If you go into a hotel, there's a good chance it goes 1, 2, 3, 5. 4 is also apparently avoided in hospital floors and the room numbers of hospital rooms. Why does this happen? How does this happen? How is it that so many people who are hugely intelligent do really unintelligent stuff? Believe crazy stuff. How does this happen? Karen on Facebook had this explanation. She said this: you can be smart and still be devoid of common sense. I worked with many people who had PhDs who could have built a rocket ship from toothpicks and a sponge, but couldn't tie their own shoelaces if their lives depended on it. They think their degrees make them smarter than everyone else about everything else, and it's difficult to convince them otherwise. Well, let's find out more. I'm going to anchor the broadcast with a conversation between myself and Dr. Michael Shermer. And there's a video of this exchange, and I've added some visual stuff to the conversation as he makes references. So if you want to watch this conversation instead of just listening to it, the link is in the description box of this podcast. First, I want to say a huge thanks out to our show sponsor. It's Nature Box, proving every day that healthier snacks can be delicious, easy, custom fitted to your particular taste buds, and a whole lot of fun. NatureBox has a fantastic website where you can start designing your snack options right away. How many snacks you want in the box? You want once a week, every 2 weeks, once a month? What are your snack preferences? Sweet, spicy, vegan, dried fruits, nuts, popcorn, what? What do you like? Handpick from over 100 guilt-free snack options yourself, or let NatureBox make some suggestions for you. Tons of options, from the crispy coconut squares to the cherry berry bonanza, to the Kung Pao pretzels, to the salt and pepper pistachios, and so many more, with new snacks added every single month. Let NatureBox be part of your plan to snack healthier for the new year. And right now, you can get 50% off your first box delivered right to your door when you go to naturebox.com/thinkingatheist. Snack smarter in 2016 at naturebox.com/thinkingatheist. Dr. Michael Shermer is founding publisher of Skeptic Magazine, a monthly columnist for Scientific American. He's a regular contributor to a ton of different publications, including Time.com. He is a presidential fellow at Chapman University. He's author of a new book called The Moral Arc, How Science and Reason Lead Humanity Toward Truth, Justice, and Freedom. He's also author of tons of other books, including one that sort of led me into this podcast. I borrowed the title and changed it just a little bit, Michael. But your book is called Why People Believe Weird Things. And I wanted to talk about that on the radio, and I thought this would be a great opportunity. Dr. Shermer, thanks for being here.
Oh, you're welcome. And I didn't know that about the adoption of the book title. That's great.
Let's talk about Ben Carson, can we? I mean, we'll just start with him.
With a straight face.
Republican presidential candidate. He's a product of Johns Hopkins. He is a neurosurgeon. He's not a stupid man. And yet, he doesn't seem to embrace or understand basic evolutionary biology. He made the claim about the Star of David being on the American $1 bill. He's mentioned that he believed that the pyramids were built so that the biblical Joseph could store grain. And we're all looking at this otherwise intelligent man, and we're wondering, what the hell is going on? Michael, what the hell's going on?
Well, he's not just a product of Johns Hopkins University. He's also a product of the Seventh-day Adventists. And in this case, his religion is trumping his science because Seventh-day Adventists are creationists. They're largely young Earth creationists, or at the very least, old Earth creationists. But they take the creationist model in any case and don't accept most of the science related to that. Now, how can you get through medical school believing that? The answer is you don't have to really understand evolutionary biology to get through med school. You can actually take all those classes, memorize all the parts and functions of the body and get through chemistry and calculus and all that stuff without actually ever studying Darwin. I'm sure he knows something about it. I'm sure he's read about it, but he just rejects it because of his religion. But it isn't necessary to do what he did. It's not to denigrate neurosurgery at all. It's a super technical field, but you don't really have to understand how natural selection works to operate on a brain. These are largely independent fields. So, I mean, in a way, it'd be like asking what does knowing about neurosurgery have to do with economic policy? Nothing. He's not qualified to understand the economy just because he's a neurosurgeon. And so you can be smart in one area and, really dumb in other areas. And that's the case for most of us. It's just that most of us aren't shooting our mouths off on national television running for president. And most of us, don't venture into fields we know nothing about and make public statements like that. And so that's the short answer. Psychologically speaking, as I say in Why People Believe Weird Things, is that smart people believe weird things because they're better at rationalizing beliefs they arrived at for non-smart reasons, or that they hold for non-smart reasons. That is, people hold beliefs for emotional reasons, psychological reasons, religious reasons, and political, ideological reasons, and then they back into it with evidence after the fact that they, filter to fit, what they already believe, the confirmation bias. And smart people, educated people, are better at that. And so they convince themselves, as well as some of their other followers, that, they're really onto something because they're so smart. But in fact, it's really just the opposite.
Let's talk about confirmation bias for those who may not know what it is. Can you sort of flesh it out for us?
Yep. So the confirmation bias is where you look for and find confirming evidence for what you already believe, and you ignore the disconfirming evidence. That is, you remember the hits, you forget the misses. You just filter out information that doesn't confirm what you want to be true, and you allow in the information that fits. Everybody does it. We do it in all walks of life. There's a huge body of literature and cognitive psychology about this this bias. It's kind of the mother of all cognitive biases. There's a host of these biases, dozens, but that's the biggest one. So, for example, just to run through a few of the experiments, like if you tell a subject that this person they're about to meet is introverted, shy, not particularly forthcoming or gregarious, and then you meet this person and fill out a little questionnaire about their personality, that's how they will be described. On the other hand, if you tell somebody else that this person is gregarious and extroverted, outgoing, and then they meet the exact same person who says the same things they will rate them as outgoing extroverts. In other words, they'll find the things that seem to fit the diagnosis or the label. This is true in the mental health profession. We know from Robert Rosenhan's famous experiment in the late 60s, he and his fellow, and he was a professor, his graduate students checked themselves into a bunch of different mental hospitals. And, you know, just all they were doing was complaining of hearing voices, and nothing very specific. And the moment they were checked in and diagnosed, they said, well, I don't hear the voices anymore. And then they acted completely normal from there on. The diagnoses were made by the psychiatrists working at these hospitals, and the you know patient descriptions were made by the employees at the hospital. The patients themselves weren't patients at all. You know, they just then proceeded to act completely normally. And as Rosenhan describes it, the other patients knew right away, oh, come on, you know, you guys are journalists or something. You're here investigating the hospital, right? You know, because they could tell they were acting normal. But the psychiatrists didn't get it. You know, they filtered everything that the pseudo patients did as further evidence of their schizophrenic tendencies and, you know, the erupting libidinal urges coming out in the painting, you know, this kind of nonsense. And then after the experiment was over, they had to get out on their own, which took many, many weeks in some cases. It's a little scary, actually. It's hard to get out once you're in. He then told these hospitals about it, and they said, oh, well, you know, we wouldn't be faked. You know, there's no way. Try it again. Send some pseudo patients and real patients to them, and we'll be able to tell the difference. And so then, you know, patients started coming in as usual, and they, you know, reported back that they figured out who it was, when in fact he didn't send anybody in. You know, so it's...
Now, what's that about? Is that they were... The staff was predisposed to automatically assume or believe that these people had some sort of psychological trouble. So they were just going to see it because they just expected it?
Correct. Yeah. The power of expectation, the power of labels and language to determine thought. It's a little bit of an indictment of the mental health profession to the extent that these psychiatric diagnoses are very subjective. You know, it's a list of symptoms, behaviors, you know, patient exhibits X, Y, and Z most of the time, but not all of the time. And maybe there's 20 different symptoms of schizophrenia. How many do you have before you get the label? Is it 10? Is it 12? Is it 15? Is it 7? You know, there's very little consistency across experts on what constitutes that particular set of characteristics that makes up a diagnosis. And it's a real problem. It's why the Diagnostic and Statistical Manual, the DSM, keeps evolving. You know, homosexuality was a disease in the 1950s, and it's finally taken out in the 70s. And you know, there's a lot of those kinds of things that are very disturbing. But, you know, in this context, I'm just talking about the power of labels and the confirmation bias, that once you have a theory about something, you then just find the evidence to fit it. Conspiracy theories work this way. You know, the moment you think that 9/11 was an inside job, then you just go back and read the newspapers and watch the news reports and go, aha, there was something very odd right there at that corner. And look at this person acting very strange. And, you know, you start filtering out things that don't fit and filtering in things that do fit. It's like the JFK assassination. You know, once you decide, okay, I think it was a conspiracy, then you look at Dealey Plaza and you look at those photographs. Famous example, there's a guy with an umbrella standing there on the, you know, on the grassy knoll there. What's he doing with an umbrella? It was a perfectly sunny day. Why would somebody have an umbrella? Clearly that umbrella was a rifle of some kind. And he had a rifle hidden, you know, built into the thing, and he shot Kennedy with it. Finally, that guy came forward in the 80s and said, yeah, I'm the umbrella man, because there was all these conspiracy theories about the umbrella man. And he said, I was out there protesting Kennedy. I was against his foreign policy and Cuba and all that. And that the umbrella was going back to the pre-World War II, when Neville Chamberlain came back from Munich after caving into Hitler's demands to acquire Austria. And so he came back and he had an umbrella. And so the umbrella became the symbol of protest against accommodationism with foreign, you know, about foreign policy.
So what, Kennedy was supposed to make that connection as he turned the corner? I mean, that's sort of a big leap, isn't it?
Oh, it's a huge leap. But again, once you have the idea in mind, then, you know, everything becomes pregnant with meaning, like, ooh, what's that? Ooh, what is that over there? And if you don't believe it, then, you know, those sort of things just go flying right by your senses.
Oh, Michael, you just guaranteed that the comment section is going to go insane with 9/11. I mean, how many years has it been? And it's even among the quote unquote skeptical community, it's especially in the month of September, it's rampant, you know, Building 7 and thermite controlled demolition. I mean, one thing after the other. The only thing missing is the Illuminati, right? But these are intelligent people.
Oh, yes, yes. Again, intelligence and belief are orthogonal, as I say in my book. That is, they're like this. They're not really related to each other. It's not like one goes up, the other goes up or down. You know, they're independent of each other, except for the fact that if you're smart and educated and very well-read, you're better able to defend the beliefs that you hold for very non-smart reasons. Anyway, that's how it works. If you're conservative, you read the Wall Street Journal. You know, listen to conservative talk radio and so on. If you're liberal, you read the New York Times and you listen to NPR. And, you know, it's just, we all filter the world around us by our beliefs. You know, we mostly want to hang around fellow liberals or fellow conservatives. We mostly want to read people that already agree with us because, it's rewarding. Feels good. You get a little dopamine hit when, you know, you read something that confirms what you already believe. And, you know, we know the neuroscience of it. But the confirmation bias is very powerful, and it's very disruptive to getting at the truth, which is why science has this self-correcting machinery built in, this peer review system. This, you can't operate in a vacuum. You need to, you know, bounce your ideas off of other people who can tell you that you're wrong, and they have to feel free that they can tell you that you're wrong, which is why we have free speech in a civil society. We need to, you know, nobody's going to get it right all the time. We need to have people bouncing ideas off each other and criticizing each other, or else we're going to go down the path incorrectly.
I was talking to the skeptic, Dr. Harriet Hall, and she was talking about sort of her acid test for when a claim is made. And of course, she's in the skepticism business, the debunking business. There's a lot of bunk out there, as I've heard you often say. And I think I'm paraphrasing, Dr. Hall, forgive me if I screw this up, but it's something like, if you hear a claim made, go and look up what the most vehement critics of the claim have to say about it and start there.
That's correct. Well, that's true not only in her field of medicine and so-called alternative medicine, but all claims. That sounds good in principle, but, you know, what does your biggest critic have to say about it? You know, oh, I don't know. I don't read those. Yeah, well, okay, maybe you should.
Hey, is it possible to live a bias-free life? I know the answer, but I just, you know, we hear this constant charge to remove bias from the process. And I think as human beings, it's impossible. What do we do with this?
Yeah, well, so far I'm the only one I know who's been able to do this. And I can't tell you my secret because, you know, it's patented. well, you know, obviously, of course not. But what we can do is try to limit the extent to which our biases can distort our perceptions of reality, our political beliefs, our economic beliefs, our religious beliefs, whatever, even our scientific skeptical beliefs, by interacting with other people and reading and listening what they have to say, reading our critics. I do try to read my critics. I don't like it. People that particularly like with my new book, you know, it's been challenged pretty seriously by a number of people. I don't like reading it because by the time I was done writing it, I felt like I was right.
Now, wait a minute. Are these religious people that are coming after you because they believe morality comes from above, or?
Yeah, well, there is that, of course, but I expected that. No, I mean from my fellow scientists and skeptics who think that, you know, for example, I argue in the moral arc that, you know, moral values can be objective and true, really, absolutely, not just culturally relevantly true, but absolutely true based on a universal human nature. And not everybody agrees with me on that. But, you know, there's been some really good criticisms that I've read that, you know, has helped me refine my thinking, helped me, you know, further develop my ideas along those ways. And I don't like everybody else, I don't like doing it. I'd rather just think, well, I'm right, that's it, I can move on to the next project. But that isn't how it works, and particularly with hard areas like that. I mean, it's debunking the 9/11 truthers or creationists or the Holocaust deniers, those were much easier targets, in my earlier books than writing about this kind of stuff, which is, it's not clear what the answer is, and no one has the right answer maybe, and that's much harder. It's more anxiety producing. You feel less stable in your work. Like, gee, I don't really know if I'm going down the right path or not. It's really hard. So like when I was writing my book, Steven Pinker gave me a lot of good feedback. And he's probably the smartest guy I know. And also the most honest. I knew he would be honest and telling me not what I wanted to hear. But, I would just send him a few paragraphs or a few pages or something and go, am I on the right track here? And, he would always tell me. And I thought, okay, this is what we all need, that. Somebody to go, nope. Hey, here's why I think you're wrong here. And he's like, oh, okay.
I invoke his book all the time, The Better Angels of Our Nature. Just a masterwork. It's just so freaking good and so rich with information,
Absolutely. And Steve's very good about crediting other people and their work. And he does that same thing. He bounces ideas off people and listens to what they have to say. All good scientists do that, and all of us need to do that including in our daily lives. Just because you might be wrong, it's the problem. I'm just writing about this problem now in my latest column in Scientific American. I just turned in yesterday on the liberal bias in social science, particularly social psychology. Jonathan Haidt has this, H-A-I-D-T, Jonathan Haidt. He's one of the great social scientists of our age, and he has this great story about he was at this social psychology conference in 2013, and he asked for a show of hands amongst about 1,000 people. How many of you are, self-identified as being on the right, political right? 3 hands out of 1,000 go up. And then how about libertarian, fiscally conservative, socially liberal? 12 hands go up. How about, to the left, everybody else? Okay. Is it really possible that social psychology can have that kind of political bias and be doing truly objective research? No. And they just published this article that came out last month in Behavior and Brain Sciences Journal. Pinker called it the most important article in the last, couple of decades in all of social science. And it's quite the good art. They really show how political bias sort of seeps into the cracks of the social science research, particularly social psychology. It's in ways you wouldn't even notice unless somebody pointed it out.
I was reading in your book that we form beliefs first, right? I believe something before I know it. Is that an accurate way to say it, Michael?
Yeah, that's right. Spinoza got that right. Spinoza said that, once you comprehend an idea, you just automatically believe it. And then to be a skeptic, to doubt it requires an extra cognitive load. That is to say, it's like lying. To tell a lie, you have to know what the truth is and then add another layer on top of it. So there's a higher, bigger cognitive load there.
Now, is there an evolutionary explanation for this? I know you've talked about the different types of, if you hear a rustling in the forest, is it the wind or is it a predator? I've heard this example. Does it relate to that at all or what?
Yes, it is, because, all these cognitive biases that we're talking about, these are what Danny Kahneman calls rules of thumb. That is, they're just kind of ways of quickly calculating what I should do next. They're sort of proxies for behavior. And that if you spend too much time, like, why can't you just sit in the grass, listening carefully and collecting more data to see if the rustle is a dangerous predator or just the wind? And the answer is dangerous predators don't wait around for you to collect more data about them. That's why they're stealthy. That's why they're camouflaged. And so we have to make snap decisions. So Kahneman calls this thinking fast and slow is the title of his book. The fast part is this rapid cognition, this intuition, this snap decisions, this sort of type one thinking, this, just assume all rustles in the grass are dangerous predators just in case, and just assume things that you comprehend are probably true just in case they are. And then later you can evaluate it gradually, slowly, you can apply reason and so on. But that comes later. So the snap decisions are the initial line of thinking for those good evolutionary reasons.
Have you seen the television show called Brain Games?
Yeah, sure.
I'm fascinated by it. It was on Netflix. I just started to watch it. And by the time I was through with the fourth, fifth episode, I was paranoid about how much I don't trust my brain. I don't trust perception anymore. It's amazing how easily we can be tricked. For many, perception is reality. I felt it, I saw it, I touched it, and therefore it is true, it is real. But our brains actually can easily trick us into something else. Can we talk about the difference between perception and reality?
Sure. So you had a very good reason to be disturbed, as all of us are that study these areas, because those kinds of tricks that they use on television shows, or that magicians use, or that people that study illusions use to show how we don't always get reality right, those actually tend to be exceptions to the rule. For the most part, your snap decisions about and your intuitions about things in the world are fairly accurate, and they work most of the time, which is why we evolved them in the first place. So, for example, you know, just think about the famous smoke in the room experiments, you know, with obedience to authority and conformity to group norms and things like that, going back to Milgram and Zimbardo and Solomon Asch and all those classic social psych experiments in which under, you know, these really weird conditions where, you know, you're sitting there in a room filling out a form with a bunch of other people and smoke is billowing in underneath the door. We did a replica of this a couple of years ago for Dateline NBC, and it was hilarious. I mean, our one and only subject, everybody else in the room was just actors working for us. You know, they would sit there and they'd look up like, there's smoke coming in the room. And they look around and everybody else is filling out their form, ignoring it. It's like, okay, so they go back to work. And, you know, it's kind of hilarious that you can get people to do that. But in fact, normally, if you were in a room with a bunch of strangers, none of whom were in on anything, and there was smoke coming in the room, they would do something. You know, it would be very unusual for everybody in the room to just completely ignore the smoke. So usually somebody does something. And if nobody's doing something, it probably does mean there's no cause for alarm. And same thing with illusions. Yes, we can trick the brain with these unusual, you know, perceptual illusions. But most of the time when you look out, what you see really is there. It isn't a trick. And so for the most part, our senses are good enough matching reality for survival purposes. And so you don't need to be that upset with those kinds of shows. Those shows are orchestrated to pick the one example where, you know, you're for sure going to get it wrong.
Let's talk about Deepak Chopra for a few, just because I always like to bring him up whenever we have an exchange. Michael, you were on, was it ABC News that put together that exchange between you guys and Chopra? Can you describe that event for me?
Oh yes. Well, Deepak had long wanted to do a debate with me at Caltech, so we finally started putting this together for an event, and then he called out of the blue one day and said, hey, I think I can get ABC Dateline or ABC Nightline to tape it. It's like, okay. So they got involved and they said, yeah, but, you know, for television, we need more action, you know, a lot of exchanges, like we want a tag team wrestling kind of event. So each of you get somebody else on your team and then we'll do 2x2, you know, debate, bam, 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 back and forth, which we did. And I got Sam Harris and he got this woman, Jean Houston, who I never heard of. And turns out that, you know, she wasn't very helpful to his side, I think. You know, usually Deepak has those quantum physicists, but she was more of sort of a mystic of sorts, a guru kind of person. But it was very very instructive, and you can watch this online. You know, Deepak stringing together these words and phrases that sound super smart, but you know, what do they really mean?
Well, that's kind of where I want to stop you for just a second. I mean, he was a physician, right? Once chief of staff at New England Memorial Hospital. He's not a stupid man. And yet he throws out all this stuff like aging is a learned behavior, like aging is a choice, you know, and he does a lot of speaking about the quantum. Did he toss out the quantum on stage with you guys?
Oh, yes. Yes. And neither Sam or I are physicists. So but fortunately for us, Leonard Mlodinow was in the audience and he is a physicist. And he was a professor at Caltech. He worked with Richard Feynman and Murray Gell-Mann. in the 1980s. And he knows this area. So he had a really funny line in the Q&A, if you watch this. You know, he stands up and says, Deepak, I understand all the words you're using, but I don't understand what they mean when you string them together that way. And this led to him and Deepak doing a book together called The World, The Worldviews. It's quite good. And that's the key difference there is Deepak has a different worldview than you and I have. His worldview is sort of a Buddhist or modified Buddhism, in which consciousness is the fundamental property of the universe and everything derives from that. Whereas you and I, as probably Western materialists, think of consciousness as derived from a brain matter, from brain activity, from neural activity. And therefore it's derivative, it's secondary. It's not a property of the universe, it's a emergent property from other components of the universe. But if you start at Deepak's position, his starting position, then what he says actually kind of makes sense if you're a Buddhist, but I'm not. So, you know, it really is just a starting point different.
Let's talk about the word worldview. Someone embraces a Christian worldview. I did this, right? I started with the answer, and then I started asking the questions because I had already assumed or embraced a truth with a capital T. We all do this, I'm guessing, in some way?
We do, yes. In fact, this is the case certainly in science as well. Maybe not worldview, but you know, when you're a graduate student in a lab, you're working under a professor, and he already or she already has a whole research protocol set up designed to test some particular hypotheses that's part of a larger theoretical model to explain some natural phenomenon. You're working within that. The chance of you, while you're working in there, overthrowing the whole paradigm is, you know, very, very small. You know, this comes much later when you're an established professor and you can sort of pull back and look at the bigger picture and try some other paradigm or research protocol. So it's the same kind of principle there. And then, of course, people that pull back even broader and say, well, yes, but that Western scientific materialist inductionist perspective of how we gain knowledge is itself flawed. This is something like what Deepak says. I mean, he loves science, but he's looking at science from a different perspective, starting with this other worldview, in which case, in my opinion, his confirmation bias is at work, and he's only picking out the weird quantum experiments that seem to fit his theory of consciousness, that sort of thing. He would not agree with that, of course, but we're all embedded in a worldview. You can't get out of it. So you just got to work within one or try to shift to a different one if you want to just take a different perspective.
You were somewhat religious for a little while until you weren't. What's one of the weirdest things or some of the weirdest things you used to believe? I mean, did you ever hold any belief or, you know, did you know something to be true? And later on you thought, geez, what was I thinking?
A lot of times, actually, this is along the same lines of what have you changed your mind about? Well, quite a few things. Just belief in God, but because I was a Christian, I just assumed I had to be a creationist. I hadn't really studied evolution or creationism. I just didn't know much about it, but I just assumed I was because I thought that was part of the package. And so when I actually started taking science courses, I realized this has nothing to do with, you know, my religious beliefs and the stuff that creationists say is, you know, no connection to reality at all. You know, so I gave up all that nonsense. But also when I was in graduate school, even though I'd abandoned religion, I still thought there might be something to the paranormal. This was in the 70s when Thelma Moss had a lab at UCLA, a paranormal lab, studying Curlian photography and psi, ESP, telekinesis, this sort of thing. And there seemed to be, you know, examples where they were finding positive results. So I thought, well, you know, I'm just a lowly graduate student. What do I know? And these are professional PhD psychologists. You know, they're smarter than me. So maybe there's something to it. And it was around that time in the late 70s that the skeptical movement began to take off. And I saw people like the Amazing Randy on TV doing the stuff that the, you know, so-called psychics were doing. And I realized, oh, well, okay, so a magician can fool these scientists. How do we really know that, you know, what these psychologists are studying is not just, they're not just being fooled. And, you know, so I began to be a little skeptical that way. And then as the years, you know, rolled on, I became much more committed to the kind of materialist scientific worldview. And it's not that we define those things out by definition, but in a way, there's no such thing as the paranormal. There's just the normal and things we haven't explained yet. So, for example, if it turned out that Deepak was right, that quantum consciousness is the theory that explains consciousness, and therefore you and I could actually read each other's thoughts through this quantum field, you know, spooky action at a distance, the double slit experiment and all that. If that were true, then that wouldn't be ESP or psychic power. That would just be some form of quantum physics and neuroscience. You know, it would just be enveloped within the scientific worldview. Now, I don't believe that, but that's my point, is that if there were evidence for it, then it would just be part of the normal world.
Is it the same concept that like once alternative medicine is proven to heal, it no longer is alternative, that kind of thing?
Right, yeah. Yeah, there's no such thing as alternative medicine. There's just, you know, medical claims that are proven and all the rest that are not proven. And I think it's Tim mentioned that says, you know, what do you call alternative medicine with evidence? Medicine.
I think about guys like you and James Randi and whatnot. I mean, you're presented all the time with stuff that you debunk. I mean, you see it, you test it, oh, come on. And you get to probably, I would assume, get to a point where the second you hear a claim, you're like, oh yeah, this is going to be a waste of my time. I mean, so then the question becomes, if someone was to one day come through with a discovery that was genuine, would you be predisposed to be skeptical against it, to disbelieve it? Are you jaded, Michael, after all of these claims have sort of fallen by the wayside?
I don't know if it's jaded so much as... it would be a little bit like asking someone like Feynman or, you know, a living physicist today who gets these alternative theories of physics in the mail every week. I get them all the time. I'm sure the big name physicists I know, people like Brian Greene and Michio Kaku, they get these alternative theories every week. You know, these are just amateurs that, you know, they don't work in the field. And, you know, Newton was wrong and Einstein was wrong and Feynman was wrong and Stephen Hawking's wrong. And, you know, this weekend I worked out in my garage the true theory of the universe. Okay. Probably not. You know, so you're sort of predisposed, yes, to be skeptical because, you know, most of these alternative ideas are wrong. And in that sense, there's nothing wrong with that, you know, because, you know, science is conservative for the very reason that most new ideas that people come up with, even professional scientists, are wrong. So it's good to be skeptical. And so we start with the default position of the null hypothesis that whatever you think is true isn't. And now you have the burden of proof of overcoming the null hypothesis that is convincing us that you're true. And I'm sure the FDA gets inundated with, you know, people that send them, you know, cold remedies and cancer cures and AIDS cures and so on. And here's my drug. Will you approve it? Not without clinical epidemiological evidence. We won't. The FDA just assumes that somebody submitting a product, it's not going to work until they, you know, present the evidence that it does. And that's true for everything in science.
Well, because now we've established that none of us are immune to bias. None of us are immune to bad information. Even I call it, and this may be inaccurate, but I call it the place in the brain where the weird shit lives. I don't know if that's scientifically tenable, but does that speak to compartmentalization? Is that even an accurate way that otherwise we're rational, except we have this one little cherished spot in our minds that we sort of protect the weird? Is there any merit to that at all, or am I just crazy?
No. I actually wrote a column, one of my Scientific American columns, called The Logic Tight Compartment, I called it. Like a watertight compartment, it's just a little barrier in there and you hold that belief. And, you know, that's our best explanation for why, you know, scientists believe in God, because we don't think there's evidence for it. And, you know, they're holding it in there as a, you know, a separate thing. You know, it's like, who's the New York Times science writer? I forget the woman's name. It'll come to me in a moment, but she had this great analogy of, you know, the physicist that goes to church on Sunday, or, you know, where's your control group? You know, for the resurrection, I believe in the resurrection. That's nice. Where's the control group? Oh, Natalie Andrews. You know, it's a great analogy. Why aren't they asking for that kind of evidence on Sunday that they do on Monday at the lab? And the answer is because they're holding them in separate compartments.
Well, I think that leads into my question. Where do we go from here? How do I sort of as best as possible, bullshit-proof my life? How do I protect against my own biases? How do I keep from outsmarting myself? What tools do you recommend?
Yeah, well, the baloney detection kit that we publish on skeptic.com, you can go there and check it out. It's just asking certain questions like, you know, how do I know that this is true? What's the evidence for it? Who made the claim? You know, have they made similar kind of claims before? What's the quality of the evidence? Everybody says they have evidence. What's the quality of the evidence? And, you know, does that claim fit with how we know the rest of the world works? You know, so you're talking about miracles, you know, like the raising of the dead, the resurrection, something like that. You know, well, it ends up kind of getting defined out of that paradigm by saying it's a one-off event. Yeah, well, lots of scientific things are one-off events. You know, meteor impacts is a one-off event. There still should be some evidence for it. You know, so you can just kind of push a particular claim into the channel of, you know, any scientific claim that would be made and ask those kinds of sets of questions that any scientist would ask about any claim. And you can apply that to, you know, political claims. You know, should we build a wall, you know, down at Mexico? You know, will that work? Or should we institute gun control measures or not? You know, will it work? Well, in principle, these are, although they appear on the surface, pure political kind of issues that we just debate and yell and scream at each other. But in principle, we should be able to answer those questions scientifically. You know, if our goal is to lower the homicide rate in America, which is, you know, on the order of 8 per 100,000, about 8 times higher than it is in Europe, and the gun-related homicides, you know, is just astronomically off the charts compared to any other developed nation. You know, what we should be able to ask ourselves scientifically: what measures can we take to reduce the numbers? That's all. You know, take politics out of it and just treat it as a scientific question. This is one of the things I try to do in the moral arc. And, you know, that most people, including scientists, my fellow skeptics, say, well, there are certain things that can't be tested scientifically. Well, I think we haven't tried hard enough. I think we should try to test everything, take everything out of the bias bubble and put it into the science machine and see if it holds up.
Congratulations on the new book, The Moral Arc. I hope it's doing well. I hope people are getting into it. I love approaching morality and ethics outside of this sort of religious ownership. You know, the church decided, well, it's proprietary and we own morality. And the moral arc actually says, not so much. And it's a beautiful thing. So congratulations on the book.
Yes, I think it's good that, you know, that, of course, you know, secular philosophers, someone like Spinoza or Immanuel Kant or David Hume, you know, they've been talking about this for centuries, but there's still this kind of barrier that scientists have, almost like the brick and mortar buildings on a campus. You know, it's like, well, the biology people are over there and the physics people are over there and the moral philosophers are over here. And, you know, most of these professors are not religious, but they still treat moral philosophy as something different than, you know, psychology or cognitive science or neuroscience or physics or biology. And people like Sam Harris and Steven Pinker and myself are saying, wait, let's break down the barriers, forget the brick and mortar buildings. Let's just throw it all in one big, you know, thing. This is science. We want to know what's the answer to this particular question.
So you're saying that the question of morality is a scientific question.
That's correct. Yes, that is what I think. And not just, you know, why we're moral. You know, we've developed a pretty good theory about that now from an evolutionary perspective. You know, we're a social primate species. We need to get along, reciprocal altruism, you know, kin selection, all, you know, these, you know, indirect reciprocity. You know, there's all kinds of mechanisms to explain why we behave the way we do. But I'm also going further than that and saying, you know, certain moral values are really better than other moral values in an objective, measurable sense. For example, South Korea versus North Korea, you know, free speech versus no free speech, you know, an open economy versus a command and control economy, you know, a democracy versus a dictatorship. The results are dramatic and measurable and different, all the way from the darkness from a satellite picture from space to the height of North Koreans versus South Koreans, which is a couple inches difference because their diets are crappy, because they have such a poor economy and so forth. You know, and so these are measurable things about what people want to flourish, to survive and flourish. You know, this is a human nature kind of thing. And what I'm arguing in the moral arc is that for centuries, we've been applying the methods of science to answer this question: how can we get more people into the, you know, realm of social conditions in which they're more likely to flourish. And we've discovered that democracies are better than this, that open economies are better than this, that having a Bill of Rights and protection of free speech and the freedom to protest or worship whatever religion you want or not, you know, these kinds of freedoms we take for granted, you know, these were hard-earned, but also well-argued from a secular perspective. And even though the people that did that centuries ago would not have called themselves scientists, because that word didn't even exist until 1830s, they were practicing what they call natural philosophy, but what we call science. They treated it all as just an empirical question. What's the best social system we can structure to get the ends that we're aiming for? And I claim that that's a scientific problem.
To get one's morality from a wizard in the sky qualifies as a weird belief. To get me back to the original premise of my show today and of this interview, Dr. Michael Shermer, you've been very generous with your time. Thanks for sort of walking us through some of the science of this. And thanks for all the great work you've done at Skeptic and elsewhere. Much appreciated. And we'll talk to you again soon.
Great. Thank you. You're welcome. And thanks for having me.
Follow The Thinking Atheist on Facebook and Twitter. Watch dozens of original videos on The Thinking Atheist YouTube channel. And visit our website for resources, links, contact information, the editor's blog, and more. TheThinkingAtheist.com.